All over the UK, thousands of historic buildings lie forgotten and neglected, often tangled up with red tape or abandoned by owners who cannot afford the repairs. Some of these are in danger of being lost forever.
English Heritage's Buildings at Risk Register has over 1,000 buildings of outstanding architectural interest that are literally falling down, waiting for people like you to turn them into homes.
You sit there at home and you look at the TV and you think, I could do that.
I dream about the house every night.
It definitely took a lot of blood, sweat and tears to get the planning permission.
In this series, you're going to see people breathing new life into derelict water towers, engine houses, windmills and churches.
As an architect, I'm passionate about our architectural heritage.
And I want to help these restoration warriors on their journeys as they reclaim, recycle and make these buildings useful again. Every structure has its own unique history, which I know will help guide these intrepid restorers.
The house with no roof?
We just knew it was a building that just deserved to be saved.
But their labours of love can come at a huge personal price, both financially...
If something goes wrong, we lose everything.
..and emotionally.
He's always working at night and at weekends. He's always working. He lives his life stressed.
When you take on a listed building, you're taking on a responsibility.
You become its guardian to pass on to future generations.
We'll be able to stand back and point to the grandkids and say, blood, sweat and tears, we converted it into that house.
I hope I can bring my vision and expertise to help these restoration warriors realise their dreams. I'm here in Kingston, near Canterbury, in Kent. For as long as records have existed, Kent has been known as the Garden of England. Fruit, vegetables and hops for the brewing of beer have flourished in its rich, fertile soil. But it's not just these crops that have blossomed. Wheat has always been the major harvest, and where there's wheat, there are mills. Thought to have been built in the early 1820s, this wind-powered mill, known as Reed's Mill, was one of over thousands that were working in Britain by the mid-19th century. But by the end of World War I, only 350 remained. Today, Peter and Nikki Fagg have a vision to bring this Georgian monument out of retirement to become a family home.
The plot of land has been in the family for the best part of 100 years, and it's just stood there as a sort of a monument in the middle of our lives.
About 4 years ago, out of the blue completely, I was diagnosed with cervical cancer, and it's through insurance and paying our mortgage off up north, it's put us in a position where we could actually afford to do this, which before it's always been a dream that we've wanted to do it.
And it would just be a travesty if we didn't actually manage to keep it in the family.
Life just doesn't really get any better than this, quite honestly, not for me anyway.
37-year-old IT manager Pete and 31-year-old nurse Nikki are not idle dreamers. Their vision is to restore the old structure while creating something for the 21st century. The tower and its surrounding land of 1 acre has been in the Fagg family for nearly 100 years. To maintain the family heritage, it's been generously passed on to Pete by his parents. After selling their house in Hull for £240,000, Pete and Nikki were left with a clear profit of £175,000, which they'll use to kickstart the build. On top of this, Pete and Nikki are also applying for a £300,000 self-build mortgage, which they'll need once their savings are all spent. These funds will be released in three stages as the restoration progresses. To save money, Pete and Nikki have also moved into Pete's parents' house, who live right next door to the mill. Giving themselves 10 months to complete the build, Pete and Nikki are about to embark on the unpredictable but exciting journey of restoration.
We've got to do it, and we will do it, and we'll make it good.
And then live on bread and water for the rest of our lives, probably.
That's right, yes.
Every restoration project has a unique story to tell. I hope I can unravel the history of this building to inspire what Pete and Nikki have taken on.
You must be Pete. Hello there.
What a beautiful day for it.
Welcome to our humble abode.
Very, very nice to meet you.
Very nice to
meet
you.
Really good to meet you.
Oh, yeah.
Hi there.
Hello.
Nice to meet Nikki. How are you?
Hi, nice to meet
nice
you.
Nice to see you. Well,
thank you for coming.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
It's great to see you. You've got yourself an amazing structure tucked down there, haven't you?
Yes.
We think so. We even had our wedding reception here. So,
did you?
So we have loads of wedding photos from 9 years ago, around the mill. It really is a special building for us.
We can't wait to get up there onto the top of it, and that's something that I've certainly never done. I think Dad might have done once in his childhood, I don't know.
That'd be a very special day, wouldn't it?
I think it will be.
For you to be in the same position as your father. Shall we go and have a look?
Yeah,
it's
desperate to see it.
When you go inside this building, you can instantly sense its unique qualities. But it does make you realise just how difficult it will be to turn it into a home.
What a fantastic structure. The great thing about buildings of this form, you never get into those conversations of, is it north facing or south facing? Can I get the light in my kitchen or not?
Absolutely.
I mean, you've got doorway there, another one there, window up there, window there, window there, window there. So you've got the opportunity here of getting fantastic sunlight into the space.
Yeah.
And obviously it's 360 degrees.
We are putting a proper sort of cap on it to do it justice, hopefully.
And what about putting the sails back on? Is that going to happen or not?
We were in two minds, actually, and fortunately the builders we've chosen are true craftsmen, and they've kind of erred us down the direction of saying, well, you've really got to.
What's your own personal view about restoration and what the style of this place is going to be like when it's done?
I think it's very important for us just to make sure that it maintains its character. That's the fundamental thing.
I think it's a huge thing, isn't it?
Yeah, we haven't got pots of money at all, so we're going to potentially have to actually use some sort of modern techniques to achieve the same result. This is going to be home for us.
The proposed plans for Pete and Nikki's home are divided into three distinct parts. The first is the mill itself, which is split into four levels. The kitchen is on the ground floor. Up on the first floor, there'll be the master bedroom. Connected by a small staircase up to the second floor is the ensuite bathroom. The third floor will be used for storage, and a new traditional Kentish cap will top the mill with wind sails. Alongside will be a new but traditional style Kentish barn, linked to the old mill with a modern glass conservatory. On the ground floor is the entrance, the utility room, a study, and the living and dining rooms. The first floor will have a gallery, a guest bedroom with ensuite, two further bedrooms, and a family bathroom. The final part of the build is a separate annex with self-contained guest accommodation and a double garage. This is a really exciting but ambitious project for two restoration novices. There are so many architectural challenges on this build, and the biggest they need to resolve is the junction between old and new, how the glass link between the sloping sides of the mill and the barn is going to be achieved.
So what is it you want me to do for you?
We thought we'd save you something easy to look at.
Thanks for that.
If possible, have a look at this transaction between the glazed link and the actual mill tower itself.
Yeah.
Because we've got some really interesting sort of shapes and curves and tilts and angles to deal with there.
You've got the curved form of the mill, you know, to make it look like it's elegant and it's meant to be, and it doesn't look awkward and
it's not
like it jars. It is probably the most important detail of the whole thing, isn't it, Rennie? It's just a case of making sure we get the materials right for the mill and the finish right and the details right everywhere.
Yeah. Yes.
Especially that glass going into the mill. I'm really excited about Pete and Nikki's plans for their dream home and how it can help them with the glass link between the mill and the barn. The tricky thing is, you've got a conical shape, which is a tapering and circular building with a kind of bone block over here. The glass is the right decision in the first place because it becomes the light, beautiful connection between the two blocks, if you like. And it's all about how that meets that. And if it looks too fussy and complicated, it'll be a mess. Being involved in the design has made me even more determined to find out as much as possible of how mills evolved throughout the ages.
Now, the first mill in Britain was built in Sussex in 1180 by a bishop who actually gleaned the design from the knights returning from the Crusades in Persia. Now, throughout the Middle Ages, and because of its prime coastal location, Kent became a place absolutely covered in mills. They were built by the church and by wealthy landowners to grind the flour of their estates. And by the early 1800s, Kent had over 230 windmills.
Pete and Nikki's restoration build has begun, but there are already underlying problems. Pete works away from home 3 days a week, and Nikki has just started a new job. And to compound this, the project very nearly didn't happen at all.
Nikki wasn't well 4 years ago now, with cancer.
Oh,
and,
really?
And yeah. It was a very sort of bittersweet thing.
That must have been a difficult time for you.
It was tough, really tough. But you do. I'm lucky to be alive. I'm lucky to be here. And yeah. if it hadn't happened, then we wouldn't be in this position to actually even remotely be able to afford to do this.
Are you okay now?
Yeah. Really well.
Thank God
really
for that.
Well. Yep. Yeah. Checkups every 6 months, but really well still. So
yeah, she's back to nagging mode and everything.
For a couple who have got no building experience whatsoever, they've actually set up this project really well. They've got a good design, a good budget, a reasonable timescale, and a really good builder. But what I'm worried about is the fact that Pete is working away for 3 days a week, and Nikki has just accepted a brand new job. And if there's one thing that you need to do to keep control of your builders and your money and everything else, is be on site every single day. And these guys aren't going to be.
In 2010, restoration warriors Pete and Nikki Fagg took on this derelict 19th century Kent windmill. They plan to convert the mill and add a brand new three-bedroom Kentish barn to realise their dream home for the future.
Great day for doing building work, don't you think?
Morning.
How you doing, mate? You all right? Good to see you. Sir. You've picked the good weather for it, haven't you?
Oh, it's fantastic.
Miserable.
Yeah, it's not really very pleasant at all.
So it's a big day today, isn't it? Timber frame day.
It's timber frame day today, yeah.
So this is where the kind of McConnell set all has to come together.
Yes.
But you've got your garage block up.
Yeah, the garage is...
brilliant.
It's getting there. It does look really good, actually. You can't see the tiles, but it's nice reclaimed tiles on the roof there, and they look fab. We're hoping, fingers crossed, this is where the Christmas bit comes in, that actually we might even be in there for Christmas.
You've got 4 weeks.
Yeah.
4 weeks till Christmas.
We'll see. If Nikki's got anything to do with it, we'll definitely be in there before Christmas.
It's one of the problems at this time of year, that you want to push as hard as you can, but the reality is you're battling against the elements, aren't you?
Yes.
The builders are cracking on with the new barn, which is being constructed from beautiful oak beams that will form the main structure. Pete's dad proudly watches as this restoration comes to life.
It's nice to see the first timber go up because you've got this big, strong vertical element here, and then you've had nothing.
Yeah.
It's the first sign of what this new structure is going to look like alongside it.
Everywhere you look, the work is going ahead at incredible speed. The annex and garage are already complete and just need fitting out. But all of this work costs money. I know they started out with £175,000, so I want to know how Pete's finances are holding up.
We're still waiting for an absolute final decision on the mortgage.
So they haven't said yes to it?
They haven't said yes to it, no.
How many pennies have you got in the bank at the minute, if you don't mind me asking?
At the moment, we've got about £75,000 in the bank. We've spent about £100,000.
£100,000 so far?
Yeah.
You spent £100,000 so far?
Yeah.
So you've spent £100,000, you've got £75,000 left in the bank.
That's
how much more do you need from the mortgage company?
We need as close to £300,000 as they'll give us. If they don't think we can finish it, they effectively won't give us anything.
When is the money going to run out that you've got left?
We've got 2 or 3 months we'd have to call a halt here if we haven't arranged something.
It appears that nothing can get Pete down, and his optimism is infectious as he takes me up to the top of the mill for the very first time.
Oh, this is the bit I've been waiting for.
Yeah.
Oh, look at that.
This should be our view.
What a view! Even on a day like today, it's beautiful. So what's going at this level again?
So it's got to have a cap on it, Which in Kent is a traditional one, a little bit like an upturned boat,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, yeah, all timber clad.
Yes, all timber clad. We're hoping to put a little wind turbine on the back.
Yes. But I think if there's anything that you can get in this building that's ecological, yeah, like, if you like, brings the building to a new age, and rather than it being a kind, yeah, of, you know, previously an industrial or agricultural piece of architecture,
yeah,
it actually becomes that, an, you know, an environmental, yeah, and sustainable piece of architecture, yes, in the, yeah, future, which, yeah, I think is an amazing thing to do.
That's fantastic.
Even though the weather's been absolutely awful, this build has gone really well. The tower itself, for the first time, is very structurally sound. The timber frame started to be built. But to be honest with you, if I was Pete and Nikki, I'd be unbelievably worried about the finances. They've spent 100 grand to date, they've only got 70 grand left in the bank account, and that mortgage offer still hasn't come through.
Every time I visit the mill, my enthusiasm and love of it grows. I'm fascinated by its dominance of the area and intrigued by its history. Neither Pete or his father know anything about when it was built or even who originally owned it, so I'm determined to help them unlock its past. My first port of call is the medieval capital of Kent, Canterbury.
Canterbury Cathedral has been on this site for nearly 1,000 years, and you can see why. It's a beautifully constructed architectural masterpiece. Pilgrims have been coming here since the Middle Ages, and the building makes an appearance in Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. But the archive here isn't just about all things ecclesiastical. It also contains a wealth of local history information, which I hope will reveal more about Reed's Mill.
Deep within the bowels of this amazing building, I discover a wonderful collection of notes on Pete and Nikki's mill.
So we've got some fantastic information here from a windmill enthusiast called C.P. Davis. Davis's archive is incredible, actually. I mean, the number of windmills that he covered throughout Kent and Sussex and throughout Europe was unbelievable. And he had 200 books just on mills alone. In here, we've got some amazing images of the mill. Look at that. Reed's Mill, Kingston. I believe this mill was built on the land leased of Westwood Estate, which was owned by one John Wood. I believe it was built for a Mr. Gouger of Margate. Absolutely brilliant. Mr. Gouger, the first miller of Reed's Mill. Now I'd just like to find out when. This is another note. Kingston Reed Mill, believed to have been built for a Daniel Gouger, so we've got his first name now, Daniel Gouger, later of the Margate Mills, and it was built from before 1824, so we're getting closer. It still doesn't tell us exactly when the mill was built. So what we've got here is a map which is dated 1819. So we've got Canterbury just here, and if we head out to the southeast along the main road, we should come to Kingston. Yep, got it there. This should be a mill symbol, clearly marking Reed's Mill, but there isn't. It's not there. So what that tells us is that this map dated 1819, Reed's Mill wasn't built. But because we've got the proof that Daniel Gouger, the first miller, was there in Reed's Mill of 1824, it gives us that 5-year window. Reed's Mill was built sometime between 1819 and 1824.
Christmas Eve, our mad dog eating snuff. Morning, Monty.
Morning.
Although I've discovered the mill's past, its future for the moment is looking bleak. With the heaviest snow in decades, all work has stopped. This means Pete and Nikki aren't able to move into their temporary home above the garage. But it's Christmas, and a welcome break from the build to relax with family and friends.
Cheers, everyone. Cheers. Happy Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Happy mortgages and building.
It's New Year, and thankfully the snow has melted, and work has resumed on the build.
I'm on site just having a quick check around. Unfortunately, Nikki's laid up in bed at the moment. She's not been so well since before Christmas, actually. But hopefully she'll be on the mend soon anyway.
For Pete, this is an important day. Although he's received an acceptance on the next stage of the mortgage, he doesn't know how much it will be.
We're going to run out of equity in February. So the valuer's here today to actually tell us how much money we can draw down against the mortgage. Our build is just a little bit different because it's a restoration project. So we've got old, we've got new, and you know, the old is actually at third floor level already. The worst case scenario on this is don't get it valued, or they come up with some problem on the... He says, well, actually, sorry, no, you're not actually. You don't satisfy tick boxes X, Y and Z.
It's a nail-biting time, waiting for the assessor to make his decision.
The mortgage gent's just gone, really good news, to be honest, that it's actually been valued 100,000 more than we hoped. Quite usefully as well, he looks like he's actually, now he's seen what we're doing and seen sort of that we're actually doing a good job of it, he's actually raised the original final value. So $750,000 is the figure now, which is fantastic.
Having the future funding in place has taken a huge load off Pete's shoulders. Now Pete and Nikki can push ahead and finish the annex, which means they can at last be together in their own space and no longer need to crash at Pete's parents.
Yes, I think we could do with our space back, particularly with the dogs, you know, around the feet. And at our age, you know, you can easily trip up. So I think, you know, it is time to move over to the garage. So hopefully that won't be too much longer.
We're so close and I can't wait to, move across here and get out from underneath Mum and Dad's feet at the end of the day.
It's spring. Pete and Nikki are nearly ready to move into their annex. I'm really keen to see how things are getting on, but I'm worried. I received a call from Pete saying he has some bad news.
How are you? Could be better. We're in a distinctly difficult situation where Nikki has got a cancer pack. So it's kind of turned our worlds upside down just a little tiny bit.
How bad's the cancer?
It's terminal at the end of the day. So we don't know. We've been told that she's not going to last a year, but we don't quite know how long we've actually got. And it's getting more and more difficult, to be honest. The better she looks, the more difficult it is to come to terms with what's actually going to happen. There's nothing we can do about that. What we need to do is just plod on with things and make sure that she gets as much time here as possible. I know Nikki. I know that actually, in my heart of hearts, she's going to surprise everybody and she's going to do really well. And I just hope that we have some really good few months before anything takes any dramatic turns. You can probably see at the moment I'm just dazed, basically. I think I throw myself into just facts and figures, really, and I've sort of had a few little sort of battles and just make sure that everything sort of logically and practically can be dealt with, you know, dealing with the pensions people and such like. But, occasionally, or more than occasionally, I have a proper moment. But, I don't know, it's just...
In 2010, Pete and Nikki Fagg inherited this derelict 19th century Kent windmill. They plan to restore the mill, build a new 3-bedroom Kentish barn, and an annex with a double garage. But their plans have been shattered with the tragic news that Nikki has terminal cancer. Understandably, the build is no longer a priority for either of them.
Hello, you.
I've decided to visit Nikki at her parents' home.
Tanya, nice to see you. Do you want to tell me what's going on?
Yes. Well, unfortunately, the cancer
that we were talking about that had been gone for quite some time seems to have returned with a vengeance. The prognosis is not good, unfortunately. They've sort of given me months rather than years, but, you know, months can be a long, long time. The build, I've had to take a huge step back from. It provides that level of complication, you know, for Pete. When I'm gone, you know, does he want to live there? Is that what he wants? Will I be in, you know, I don't want to taint a house of memories if he's going to live there with somebody else, you know, in years to come.
You can't think like that. Okay. You can't think about you tainting somebody. The whole reason why he's doing it was because of you and that house and you being there, really. It's...
I really want to be involved because I think there are big bits of the build that are really important that I've... They're kind of passing me by, and I really want to sort of grab it all back in and be part of it all again, be able to interfere a bit more, nag him a bit more.
But time is more important than money at the minute.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Much more important.
To see a cap on that mill would just, it'd just be amazing. So, yeah, it needs to happen, definitely.
It's spring, and Nikki and Pete have decided to move on site into the newly finished annex apartment above the double garage. For Pete's mum, Sandra, the strain of coping with Nikki's illness and holding the family together is taking its toll.
There's quite a lot going on. I think trying to sort of hold it all together, you know, for everybody is quite difficult.
Pete has found a new hidden strength and has become positive again. He's bought Nikki a special present, something she's always wanted. And if that hasn't taken her breath away, after 4 months of not visiting site, he hopes seeing the mill will lift her spirits.
Oh my goodness. That's it for ages. Crikey. God, it looks so different.
Just a little bit.
I could cry. It's just amazing. Absolutely amazing. You look at the foundations and they look really tiny on the ground. And now it just looks hideously big. You see all the rooms and where things will be, and you get a real picture of how it's going to pan out. It's just...
Are you chuffed?
Yeah.
Chuffed a bit.
More than chuffed.
Yeah.
Beyond my wildest dreams.
Pete and the builders are throwing everything at this project so Nikki can see her dream home.
I don't know how he does it, really. He's just there all the time for me when I need him, and there at work when they need him, and I just, yeah, I'm in awe of him, really, because he's just done such an amazing job here, and he's been so desperate to get it ready for me so that, you know, I can come and stay when, like, for parties and stuff like now, so... Bless him, I just can't thank him enough. He's just amazing.
In terms of how we decided to proceed after we found out what was going on, we just let the dust settle a little bit and just got our heads around it, checked out the financial situation, which has turned out to be, you know, pretty reasonable at the end of the day. And looking at how Nikki's doing as well, I think we've made the right decision, because we can have what we wanted and we can have that for as long as she's well, which is great.
It's looking amazing. The last time I was here, things were kind of grinding to a halt for very obvious reasons, but looking at it today, it's cracking on. You know, the builders flying with the main part of the structure. The windmill's looking pretty good as well, to be honest, still got the scaffolding up. But what's happening over here today is they're building the cap, which I think is going to be absolutely beautiful.
All windmills are topped with a cap on which the sails are fitted. As the sails turn, they drive the huge stones which grind the wheat into flour. The cap is able to rotate through 360 degrees, so that whatever direction the wind blows, the sails will always be able to face it. Sadly, Reed's mill lost its cap in a devastating storm in 1915. A sorry sight for such an iconic building. Replacing the cap will, for Pete, complete its restoration.
It's monstrous. It's huge.
It's a big old structure, isn't it?
It's looking really good. And this is only taking shape in the last few days, literally.
This is something that you didn't really want to do, did you? Because the planners insisted.
No, we didn't want to do it. And because the tower stood like it has been for the last 95 years, and we just thought, why change it completely?
Yeah.
But I have to say, and with Mike's assistance, we've come around to the idea of thinking, well, actually, that's really quite a good investment. What's quite nice is that this has taken a few design twists and turns. Just the price of steel has meant, actually, it's the same cost to do the bulk of the frame in oak as well.
But it's a hell of a bit of structure.
Yeah.
So you're going to have sails on it?
Yes. There will just be a framework. There will be a fairly substantial framework, but there will be sails on there as well.
Where's Wonder Woman?
Hello.
My superhero.
How are you doing?
How are you, lovely?
I'm all right. Oh, good to see you.
And you. Really good to see you.
Last time we saw you, it was, you know, I was going to take a step back, but I can't help myself now. Yes, I might not be around as long as I hoped to enjoy it, but man, I'm going to enjoy what time I have in it.
And yeah, definitely.
That's what it's all about now, and not this stupid, I'll take a step back and I won't have anything to do with it, and I won't sleep in there and I won't do this. I just needed to get a grip, and I think I finally got that grip again.
So how do you feel about trying to get up to the first floor?
I feel I can probably try it today.
Sure?
So yeah, definitely.
Okay, let's give it a go.
Let's go.
This is a huge step for Nikki.
I'll take your hand there if you like.
Ever since she was diagnosed with cancer 4 months ago, she's never seen the upstairs of her new home in the barn.
Well done.
It's like climbing a mountain. Just go over there, actually.
You ready?
Yeah.
You okay? Well done.
Thank you.
take a break for a second.
Just breathe.
Can you give me a hand? I'm just worried about this stack. Tiny little steps.
It's just beautiful. Look at that frame. God, it's all plastered and everything up here.
It's quite some room, this one. It's quite some room. No, it's just fab.
I'm never coming to a building site with you ever again.
There's only good tears, it's not bad tears.
I love this.
Oh my goodness. Oh, God.
Come to Mama.
Good gracious, that view. I think you might need to pinch me. Is it really awesome?
Yeah, it really is.
There's no doubt about it that this building project has turned a massive corner. There's such a momentum and drive on site. The progress now is absolutely brilliant. And you can feel the buzz for Pete and for Nikki and how much they absolutely love this building project, and they're putting their heart and soul into every single part of it. But what worries me is that housewarming party is still a long way off.
In 2010, Pete and Nikki Fagg started work on this derelict Kent windmill. Their plans to restore the mill and build a brand new three-bedroom Kentish barn with an annex was shattered with the news that Nikki has terminal cancer. Nikki and Pete's courage and determination to try and see the build through has given them some strength to come to terms with the situation. The historic day when a new 3.5-ton cap and sail is proudly reinstated on the top of the mill has arrived.
Good morning, mate.
Good morning, young man.
How are you?
Yeah,
you all right?
Not so bad.
Good. Big day.
Just a little bit, isn't
Massive
it?
Day today.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable. So exciting.
Yeah.
What I like about it looks quite contemporary.
Yeah.
Yeah, you've got that slightly modern twist on an old building when
That's
it goes
it.
On there.
Yeah. No, I think it's going to be really, really good.
Beautiful. I see you've got a crowd.
Yeah, we've got a tiny little audience there. No pressure for Mike or anything.
Look at you. You look fantastic.
How are you?
Really good. How are you? You all right?
Not too bad.
Good. So what's it been like getting to this day, the last few weeks?
Quite a trauma, actually, to be honest. Mike and the guys have absolutely pulled out all the stops. So it's Monday today, and they were here Saturday and Sunday to make sure it happened, which is just fantastic. But unfortunately, we've had some news that Nikki's chemo has not been effective, so we've had to draw a halt to that. And it's kind of added the impetus to say, right, let's crack on with it. There will be no delays. And
it's great to see her here today.
Yeah, she's looking well, to be honest. She's looking a lot better for not being on chemo, to be honest. But she's looking good.
She's looking great.
Yeah.
That's it, just took it off.
What an amazing thing to see, eh? Over 90 years ago, the cap was blown off by the storm, and to be standing here today seeing this being lifted back into place is just incredible. I mean, you just have this incredible sense of history that you're seeing something important today.
It's a good view from here.
Not that far off.
It's got to sit absolutely right on the top of the mill.
Perfect.
It's unbelievable the way the guys are working today. They're really pulling out the stops as fast as possible to get these sails on, because Nikki's got to leave at 3 o'clock for another little batch of radiotherapy. And everybody on site wants to see this. We want to see those 4 sails in place and with the cap on in all its glory, so we're up against it.
From the other side, but wow.
Oh, watch your heads.
here we go.
I think to Pete and Nikki as well, actually.
To everybody.
Come on, if it wasn't for you two, you wouldn't have pulled this off.
Yeah.
Well, you're together, you've done it.
To everybody.
Thanks,
thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Super.
Been a great
day. Thank you very much.
Right, see you on.
See you later.
Cheers.
Bye, bye.
After being in the family for over 100 years, this iconic building in this landscape has finally been brought back to life by our two restoration warriors. Despite all the setbacks, their vision to create a dream home has never left them. Tragically, Nikki never got to see their dream come true. In August, she lost her fight against cancer. It's September 2011, and in memory to Nikki, work has started again on the restoration of the mill. In one of the most complicated parts of the build, the specially designed glass panels are carefully put into place to form the link between the tower and the barn. With work almost completed on site, my attention's been turned to try and find the missing pieces of the puzzle in the history of Reed's Mill. We know that the first miller was Daniel Gouger in 1824, and with the Industrial Revolution sucking thousands of people into the cities, the demand for flour became enormous. Throughout the 19th century, this demand grew, and so did the need for mills. In fact, mills and flour were a great way of making a profit. Now, the next time Reed's Mill pops up on the historic radar is in 1881, when this funny character, Johnny White, a miller, bought it. In 1914, Pete's grandfather bought the mill and the adjoining farm. But the storm of 1915, combined with World War I and the introduction of steam-driven mills, meant that Reed's Mill fell into disuse, but it's remained in Pete's family ever since. This historic building had been abandoned for over 90 years, until Pete's dad decided to let his son breathe new life into it. In September 2010, I met Pete and his wife Nikki as they started out on their quest to convert the family mill into a home. The journey's been incredibly difficult and emotional for all involved, but the restoration is now complete.
The last time I was here was over 5 months ago, the day when the cap was going on top of the windmill. There's still a fair bit to do. I've been told that the build is completely finished and I can't wait to see that glass link. I think we're going to see something quite special today.
This is a truly exceptional restoration project where old meets new.
Hello, man.
Hello, sir.
You all right?
Not too bad. Not so bad.
It looks amazing.
You've got something. I've been a bit busy.
I bet you have.
But
from the outside, it looks incredible.
Yeah.
Absolutely beautiful.
It's fantastic.
Look at that.
You cannot do anything but smile when you walk through the door. It's just gorgeous, basically. As well, in my opinion, anyway.
I think it's a fair opinion.
Yeah, though. I think it's pretty reasonable. Pretty reasonable.
The barn's unique design and use of natural light is really well done.
I love the open plan feel to it.
Yeah.
The way that you've got living here, little desk just around the corner there, it's got its own little niche.
Yeah.
And then you come around entrance hallway, dining, wood burner, all linked and connected together. Does it feel like home here?
It's getting there, definitely, because I haven't seen my furniture for 18 months. And it's nice to see it all again, and it just... Yeah.
Have you stayed here yet? Or have you literally just moved the stuff in? You haven't
literally,
stayed in here?
Not quite, no.
This is literally the first day it's been finished.
This is literally the first day it's been finished, yeah.
Love the wood burning stove.
Oh, it's fab, isn't
it? Absolutely fab.
The design downstairs is complemented by 3 spacious bedrooms upstairs. Although a new build, the traditional and beautiful workmanship makes you think it's been here for decades. There's no doubt that the new barn works, but it's the glass link to the old mill that I'm really excited about.
And what do you reckon to that then? Is that not just something else?
Speechless.
Yeah. Which is unusual for you.
Which is unusual for me. You're absolutely right. But if there was ever a building, if there was ever a restoration project, where old, very old, meets something that wants to be old, that meets something that's undoubtedly new, it's just brilliant. It couldn't work any better. And the challenges that you face to get that glass to meet the curve of the mill while it's sloping at the same time, it was really difficult.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Having the staircase inside the new glass link saves space and really brings the old and new together.
I love this. You're so close to the mill, you literally just want to hug it. Look at that, you're hugging the building as you walk up it. Magical. Absolutely magical.
What was once just a roofless, derelict shell has been recycled into a unique and beautiful home.
Oh, actually, one thing we forgot to mention is the old brickwork on the outside.
On the first floor is a master bedroom. And above is a new ensuite bathroom.
That is fantastic. What a brilliant, brilliant bathroom.
It's a clever use of space in a room that has curved and tapering walls. Where once was just a pile of rubble and weeds is now a state-of-the-art kitchen.
And what a beautiful kitchen it is. Look at that. Perfect.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It is.
Perfect.
Pete and Nikki Fagg began an incredible journey of restoration. Sadly, Pete has had to finish it alone. As custodian of the mill, I want him to understand its history so that one day he can pass it on to future generations.
It's an important day, isn't it?
It's a very important day.
Very important day. This building all finished, all done, and you in it.
Yeah.
I've got something for you. A little gift.
Thank you.
Reed's windmill book. And this is everyone's journey, really, not just yours.
Yeah.
Probably everyone's journey over the last, year and a half?
Yeah.
You've been filming. A bit of history, timeline, which I like. Look at that. Can you believe that?
Yeah.
That's all that was there.
Yeah.
That was a great day.
It was.
I love that shot, actually. Guys up on the roof. And more and more and more about mills. All the old photographs, all the old drawings. And you too. Tell me, get me coming again. Well, cheers, everyone. Well done for all your hard work. Last but by no means least, a huge cheers to Nikki.
Cheers. To Nikki.
Cheers, everyone. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. Cheers.
Pete is just the most amazing guy. He's had the toughest time imaginable. But it's a sign of his integrity and his strength that, along with all the love and support he's had from his family and with a brilliant team of builders behind him, he's managed to turn this old abandoned mill into the most beautiful home. But remember, none of this would have been possible without Nikki. Everyone is heartbroken that she can't be here to celebrate today, but what a legacy she's left behind. Pete has set up a trust in memory of Nikki. If you'd like more information about the trust, or if you're interested in restoration, or any other aspect of the series, please visit channel4.com/restorationman.